Okay. So my topic is Hail Hydra, the future of web APIs. So many of you might have been confused and might be thinking of this meme right now. But I'm not going to be talking about that Hydra. This Hydra is a bit different because it's about APIs. And when it comes to APIs, we are trying to do something new. And at the moment, you might be also relating APIs with this meme. Like recently, there was a trend. If you're a Malayali and if you're a fan of Balarama, you know this. There's an issue, right? I'm not going to extend upon that. So are we going to replace APIs as they are made now? No, that's not true. APIs are not going to change. But the question that we have to ask is this. Are APIs, as we make them right now, easy to work with? OK, so if you have to get to that point, we have to know how APIs are made. How many here have made web APIs? Yeah, right. OK, so I started making web APIs like 5 months back. I was working on a project with Subin here. Can you raise your hand? Yeah. So I was working on a project with him, and it was a hackathon-like thing. And we had to come up with something that was to replace what is currently known as Kerala Rescue. So Kerala Rescue had a problem with the whole data set being dumped in a single JSON file. Instead of using that, we wanted to make the same rescue application with more endpoints so that we can get the data only for the particular information that we want, not the whole set as such. So right now, we make APIs like hotcakes. So what do I mean by that? When we are making an API, we start with the URL structure. We finalize it. We make sure that the particular URL will give you a particular set of data, right, in JSON form. That data is serialized and sent over as JSON or JavaScript object notation form. So these are endpoints that give you JSON form, right? And at this particular point, most APIs fail because if an API has to actually succeed, it has to be documented well. At the end of the day, if a person is going to use an API, they need to know what the API endpoint is for. Simply making an API and not documenting it will be a very big possible situation where you don't succeed. So documentation is pretty much required. And right now, yeah, since the code of conduct says that I don't have to use such words, I have blocked it out. But still, this is true. OK? APIs are very unique to that particular use case. OK, I'm going to actually use that word. So they are hard-coded. APIs are hard-coded. OK? So when it comes to hard-coded APIs, that's a huge learning curve. You have to start with an API from the very basics. It's like you are starting with the Twitter API, and then 3 months later, you are again starting from the basics for another API, maybe Facebook, maybe Messenger, et cetera, et cetera. And when it comes to these things, they are very brittle. Because when you are using an API and they change from one version to another and they are not supporting back propagation, right? When they are not supporting the last version and they just move towards the new version, many of the clients break very easily. And even if you don't have to actually work with third-party APIs, maybe you're not working on another company's API and all you're working on is your own API, right? Still, you have to make sure that you make documentations. And documentation is really, really troublesome. Because at the end of the day, you need to know the whole structure. And even though there are millions of people using that API, you're the person who is responsible for making this documentation. Right? Maybe it's different in open source communities, but still, when it comes to APIs, you have to work on this extremely ridiculous task of documenting again and again when you're making iterations to your API. So how do we change? Right, how do we improve? This is in Hindi, but still, I hope you can understand how we can change. So let's get to the root of some jargon before we move forward. Linked data. So it is a recommended best practice when it comes to connecting pieces of data, pieces of information. And we use the semantic web as such to make a structure that is easy to understand. This thing is used in most of the applications that you see in open source. So Wikipedia uses a lot of these linked data information sets. If you search for RDF, you'll understand what it is all about. Okay. I'm going to be including a lot of links because I myself am a noob in this particular field. And it's just because I have worked on this particular process of developing this current iteration that I am here to talk about it. I'm not really a guru or an expert on the topic. I'd have to convince you that. Anyways, okay. So do use Google or DuckDuckGo or whatever to get more information about this topic. So when it comes to how we get the identification, right? Each and everything has a particular identity. Like hashes, there is also one identity that we ourselves imply to that particular object. So when it comes to links, URLs, you are giving a URL to a particular object. So a JSON body, a JSON file, will obviously have a URL that is specific to it. If you're changing it, it does change, but otherwise, it's always going to be unique. And this is a uniform resource identifier, URI. Right. It is an identification that is given to a particular object or a particular object, yeah. So the HTTP URI is particularly interesting because it is just an HTTP URL. You also know it as hyperlink. And the resource description framework. We use triples, and this is how it is stored, how data is stored, connected, and how you see data actually connected or linked, rather, within Wikipedia articles. So there's a Wikidata guy here. You can understand a bit more about how they write articles for Wikipedia. It's really interesting. Though it's troublesome to actually come to the conclusions, it's not about opinions. You're actually giving connecting articles to show context so that it doesn't happen to be just a blank article where you're giving up opinion. You're just not giving opinion, you're giving actual facts. And that is what Wikipedia tries to come to. So, if you are coming to this particular topic, we should come through a few examples, right? When we are coming to the topic of linked data, you need to know why it is important. So we have, let's think of ourselves as the dark Sith, right? Let's think of ourselves as that. And we have the Death Star to take control of. And in our API structure, we define the Death Star with this particular API. You can use the source here that I have given, Swappy, to get more data regarding Star Wars. It's an API that has all the data about stuff that is shown in Star Wars. And here you see name, model, manufacturer, length, crew, passenger, all the information that is related to this particular vehicle or a ship within the Star Wars franchise, right? So how do you break an API? It's very easy. You just add some more information that is not there already, or you delete information that was already there. When you come here, you see some more information here, like consumable, hyper rating, etc. That's been added. So by just adding something, you break the client, right? With a few lines of changes, you break the client. This is very unreliable, because at the end of the day, when you're passing on information, you require some reliability from your client. It's not going to be like the whole thing is going to be unstructured, and then at the end of the day, because of a small missing comma, the whole thing dies, right? With inside the text. Otherwise, it'll break, that's for sure. Anyways, I was not allowed to include a Star Wars parody. Yeah. Some of you might get that joke. I hope you do. Anyways, building APIs with the Hydra documentation format, right? Hydra is self-documenting, which means when you're making the API, you're documenting it within itself. To show this, I would have to use the example. Excuse me. Okay. Yeah. So you see here on the Hydra ecosystem website. If you want to note the website link, it's given here, hydraecosystem.org. Anyways, continuing in the topic, it's all about hyperlinks and semantic annotations. So when you're coming to the web of the future, it's going to be interconnected. It's not going to be a simple hard-coded piece of code within your API client that says that at this particular link, you will get this particular type of information. It's more regarding what it's less structured in the server, and it's more structured at a specification level. So that instead of using the hard-coded code, you're using a particular specification. And this specification is provided by, I'll give you the link, schema.org. How many people know about schema.org? Excuse me, sorry. How many people know schema.org? Please raise your hands. OK. Yeah, so Google, Microsoft, Yandex, et cetera, these are very famous companies, right? They don't actually agree too much. But when it comes to the web, they did agree on one thing, and that is schema. So schema is maintained by W3C, right? And it is a web specification where they give in information. Sorry, it's not specifically maintained by W3C, but it's also supported by them. And Hydra is a W3C specification. So how many people know about W3C? Yeah, right, a little bit more numbers, OK. These are the people who make HTML, et cetera, type of specifications. And w3.org is their website. Yeah, they are also supported by W3, yeah. OK. So coming to this point, W3C and schema.org specifies a lot of structures when it comes to, sorry. Yeah, so you can see here there are a lot of types of information, because each of the objects have a particular type. And when you come to the types, these can be extremely atomic or extremely descriptive. Many kinds of information, so there's a lot here. I'm not going to go into it. You can go and search about it more later on. Anyways, when it comes to this, you use context, ID, type, right? Vehicles is not important, but the rest three are pretty important, because when it comes to defining objects, you need to know what the context is about. And contexts are what you define for your particular use case. So a context is basically a worldview that you create for your API. When you create an API, it needs to be able to process data and send it over through a layer, through JSON forms, that are actually understandable to the console. And when it comes to Hydra, we are trying to achieve such agnostic framework for APIs that when it comes to a client, it's extremely general. And by general, I mean that you don't make a specific client for Twitter, a specific client for Facebook API, et cetera. Right? You make it pretty general. And when it comes to general API clients, they do break. And how do you solve the problem of breakage within APIs? That's not such an easy thing. You need to come to conclusions where rather large organizations come to, they make organizations like schema.org where they settle upon a particular structure that is known as a schema. And here you see a JSON-LD file. If you go into it, it's a bit more detailed as to what that particular context is. What kind of information can be stored in this particular JSON file? Yeah. So here we are seeing two kinds of JSON forms. One here has the vehicles tag. The other one has a members tag, right? So this one is supposedly the entry point. This is where you go to find out what that API is having. It's basically the slash API endpoint. And this one, the vehicles API slash vehicles, this is not an entry point. This is a collection. This is basically an array of the kinds of information that can be stored within it. And you see here different types of IDs, types, etc., etc. IDs here, okay? These are just names, URIs. So this is a URI here. This refers to a JSON form that is held within the server and contains other types of information that is related to this particular type here, vehicle. So vehicle is a ship here, and this is just one of the vehicles. You come from a collection to that particular model or that particular object. Sorry. Yeah. So you come here and you have IDs, context, etc., etc. The same things that you saw earlier. And here you see more information, specific information. So why do we require such extremes of specification or specifying details? Because when you're building an API, how many people here have built APIs that are extremely simple, like just a data API? Right, it's pretty easy. It's very easy. You don't have that kind of responsibility where you have to go into details, you have to just send small, small bits, small, small packets of information. You're sending the whole endpoint, the whole database as such. And this is a problem that I saw with most APIs. This is not how you're supposed to do it. You're supposed to go in and make specific endpoints that provide specific data. And when it comes to that particular point, you come to the hard-coded, right? I'm using the word again, still. You come to that particular point where it's all hard-coded. And when the problem with hard-coded APIs is that at the end of the day, everything breaks. Believe me, it breaks. If you add an information that is not supposed to be processed by that particular endpoint, it breaks. And you get a lot of irregularities. These irregularities are a real problem. And that is why such information has to be maintained within schemas. I hope you're keeping note of the links, because most probably I am not understandable. OK, anyways, coming to the point of what this can be used for, we are working on a universal server. A universal server is a server that is able to process all kinds of Hydra APIs. So how do we work on this? There's a documentation. A documentation is how you specify what the API is all about, what kinds of endpoints this API has, what kinds of data it can process, what kinds of data it sends over, etc., etc. Then we have a parser. So this is the most important point. Because when you're building APIs, you might build it in different languages. So language means specifications. Like there's Open API specification. How many people know about Open API specification? Yeah. Open API specification, there is RAML, etc., etc. There's a lot of different types of API structures. And these structures need to be passed into a convention that is Hydra-enabled. Hydra, that is hypermedia-driven APIs. OK, I'm not talking about the Captain America Hydra. I'm talking about hypermedia-driven APIs. So it's all about hypermedia. And what's hypermedia? It's hyperlinks. Hyperlinks are basically information that is stored on the internet with particular linking structures, URIs. And that is what it's all about. And this is the RDF, right? Classes, properties, and collections. Here you see endpoints. That's particularly important because instead of making hard-coded endpoints, you're going to this particular server and you're telling it that you are about to do something and you are using the classes, the properties, the collections, and that is how you have to make it. So instead of making it hard-coded, you're giving the responsibility of making these endpoints to the server, right? And the server is enabled with its understanding of the Hydra structure to build these endpoints. Let's go to a demo. Before that, let's see what Hydra is all about. So we are working on this particular server here. It's not very active. It's a GSOC project right now. So if you're interested, do come and join the chat group on Gitter. There's a demo here. It's right now running on my laptop. But the problem is that I couldn't set up the drones. It's a flock drone API. So how it works is basically you have 4 drones or 5 drones, how many drones ever you so want. And these drones are connected through a central controller. And what this controller does is basically sends over API information. And the API endpoints on the drones collect this information and send over the data that they have. So basically, it's interoperable in nature. So the future is all about IoT. And what is really interesting about IoT is that it's going to be connected to the internet. So you don't have to actually send over data to it to upgrade its structure, software, and all, right? So instead of doing that hard stuff, you just define what the data is supposed to be in a central server, and the IoT device just goes and refers to that server all the time. And that's what the controller is for. It specifies the specifications, the schema that these drones have to use when they are controlled by the controller. Right. So this is the API endpoint. And I hope I have not taken a lot of time. I'm not going to go into a lot more information. I'm just going to give you some more links before I end my talk. So if you want to know more about Hydra, there is the Hydra CG group. And we are working on hydracg.com/spec. So what is specification? This specification provides you more information about what you should do when you're building a Hydra framework structure. It's more like a server. We use RDF and other kinds of web technologies to build the future of IoT interoperability. Sorry. So do take notes of the links, because they are pretty important to learn more about it. So some self-promotion. You can get to my article, blog.devdutt.me. And I have some links over there. So I hope I have not taken much time. That's it. Thank you.
See, the reason that most people specialize, build specific APIs is that suppose you, HTTP is a poor example. Suppose you have something like a remote procedure call or something like that. You need high performance. You can't simply insert multiple fields and do it. And in case of a drone swarm, it's perfectly fine if the drone swarm is moving at, say, 1 meter per second. But if you are, say, doing it in a military environment or a rescue or something like that, there's no room for lag. There's no room for delay. You can't take excess bandwidth for that. So what's your solution to that?
This is completely decentralized in nature. Because unlike using particular server, a special server for this particular use case, you're using servers that are closer, that are more decentralized in nature. So for if you have a particular use case, you don't use a different server. That's as easy as that. You don't go to a Google server to control what's right next to you. Right? That's what the idea is, basically. You should be able to define it at your home at the end.
Isn't it a bit over-engineering? I know that APIs may change over time. Like if you're talking about maintainability of over 15 or 16 years, then it may change. But we have API versioning for that, right? And if you're talking about something like dynamic binding, we do have things like WSDL or service descriptor languages or service discovery frameworks. So what's the point of putting one more dynamic binding there?
So this is special case. This is special case use, right? You don't make Hydras just to solve the Twitter API problem. This is more about the free software approach to it. Because what we are trying to do is make a specification. And what is the use case of a specification? It's all about freedom. When you are able to have a specification that says that if you're building an API, you have to use this particular specification, it means that it's interoperable in nature. So that instead of using a particular SDK, like what Twitter provides, you have a very specific nature document that says, this is how APIs are supposed to be built. So if it is adopted by all the companies, it comes to the end that anybody is able to work on APIs. There's no starting learning curve for each and every API. If you start with an API, you just basically flow.
Actually, you mentioned about the open API specification, right? The Swagga, etc. is actually using the... So basically, what is the benefit of API is it should be self-explanatory and simple. In the case of you mentioned about the Twitter and Facebook, the schemas will be changing, or if the website I'm building will be changing. So what is the actual advantage when you mention about this particular one when it's interoperable? I didn't understand actually.
Hydra is extremely lightweight. Instead of OpenAPI and other kinds of extremely large sets of properties and all, Hydra is extremely, extremely lightweight. So what we are trying to achieve with it is complete, embedded system IoT. That's what it is all about. Using the web to control IoT devices. So at the end, the Hydra specification is just one page. I'll show it to you. It's extremely lightweight. That's what it is all about. Hydra is a lightweight vocabulary to create hypermedia-driven web APIs.
So there's one more thing that I find particularly, I can't agree with what he said. The reason OpenAPI is so extensive is because it has to encompass everything. If you put it, make it lightweight, you are generally restricting it to what can and cannot be done in the API.
Yeah. So I understand your point. Hydra at large is not trying to achieve what Twitter has achieved. Hydra is more like it's going to be a core vocabulary for IoT devices and other such smaller use cases. At the end, even if you're using the OpenAPI specification, you can use a parser to create Hydra. So basically, we say don't use the particular specification itself. Use whatever language you want to use. Let it be OpenAPI, RAML, etc. At the end, you can pass it into Hydra specification.
So how is this different from just a basic JSON dump?
It's very different because it's all about URIs. We are using URIs, and so it's more constrained in nature about how we understand it. It's extremely documented in nature, and it's all linked.
Even so, you are asking someone to give up the normal HTTP and JSON and constrain themselves to this API for minimal, what I see, minimal benefits.
Perhaps we can take this debate offline because we are short of time.
Yeah, so before I end it all, this Hydra was brought in by Marcus Lanther. So it's pretty much important that if you want to understand more, you go to this particular console that he created. So it's Marcus Lanther. I'll give you the link offline. Anyways, there's an extensive documentation of how the actual process is within a console. So do try to understand that as well.